for Christmas. And it's a camouflaged fighter plane.
Mm-hmm.
And you wind it up, it rolls across the floor, turns over, does a, you know, like a dido, and then rolls again. And you talking about a piece of metal, that thing is really heavy. They made toys back then.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
well, that's what a great keepsake that is. Hang on to that forever.
Well, my daddy hung on to it for a while. I forgot I had it, and he called me one day and said, son, come out here and get your toy. I didn't know what he was talking about. Went out there, and there he had it.
What a treasure.
Yeah. And marbles. We used to play marbles.
Mm-hmm.
And we played for keeps. Call it.
Yeah.
Are we going to play for fun, or are we going to play keepers today?
That's right, and that was a big deal. And probably your mama didn't like you playing for keepers.
Oh, no, didn't like to play for keepers.
That was,
didn't want me playing for keepers.
That
no,
was
no, no.
gambling, and she knew it.
And she knew it. Well, I've got a quart bottle, or a quart jar, full of my marbles that I won. Still got them. And they look good sitting there in that quart jar.
Yeah, they'll stay there forever.
Them, 60 years ago, they made marbles. Real fine, you know, you had your shooters, and you had your cows, and you had your snake eyes, and all those. And so that's what we did for fun, besides playing sports.
Yeah, a lot of marbles. I remember the marbles well. That was a national pastime, just about like baseball.
Well, we had two games. The bullseye. You remember that?
Yeah, tell me
draw,
about
draw a bullseye. And then have to pitch and start shooting. And then, of course, we had the circle. And
did you have the pigtails?
No, I don't recall that. I just recall the bullseye and the circle.
Yeah.
What's pigtail?
Well, it's a different kind. It's a different kind of circle. It's long and narrow. It's still a circle, and the lines crossed at the end, and you put all the marbles in there, and that's where you started from. It's kind of hard to explain. If I could draw it for you, you'd recognize it immediately.
Well, I knew that we just drew that circle, put them in there, and we always started out with the worst marbles. We kept what we considered our best, you know, till we got down. If you was losing, you had to pull out your best, and that's what everybody was gunning for.
Every neighborhood, every group, every school had one kid there who was a real marble hustler.
Exactly. I ran into some of them.
Me too. And if you think back, you'll remember their names, because they would take all of your marbles, but you just thought, if I had one more shot at this little clown, I can get my marbles back and get some of his.
Get my marbles back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great fun.
All right, bud.
Fun.
Take care of yourself.
Have a good day.
Thank you, sir. 1-800-572-8255. Radio 960, the new WRFC.
It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon in any town across this land. There's a kid in a room watching a screen, the universe at hand. He's got a high-speed motor,
as we go to Inman, South Carolina, and talk to Calip. Hello there, big boy.
Good morning, Ludlow.
Good morning, my friend.
I've got two toys that were my favorite. One was store-bought, and one was homemade.
Okay.
The first the store-bought one was a set of, you know what lead-burning set was? You know what a lead burning set was?
A lead is like a wood burning set, only you use lead. I don't know.
Well, it's where you took the little lead pigs and put them in your ladle and you melted them down.
Okay.
And then you took the ladle and you poured them into the little cast iron casting.
Okay, I do remember those.
And then you made your little toy soldiers or.
I do remember those. Yeah.
And you could take them apart, you know, and then take a little file and file them down and make them all nice and smooth and then paint them.
Great fun. And then have something to play with forevermore.
Oh, yeah. And then if the gun on the soldier broke off, well, you could just melt him back down And the only problem with that, when you painted them, why, the paint would make a scum up on top of the lead. And you always had to throw that away. So my dad got the set for me. I think he had an ulterior motive. Because along with the set, it also had a set of moldings for lead sinkers for fishing.
Exactly right. I remember all of that, except you were apparently more advanced than anybody I knew, because we never painted them.
Oh, I did, absolutely.
They stayed that gray color for till you melted them back down.
Yeah, and the more you played with them, the grayer, dirtier they got. Okay, that was the store-bought one.
Yeah.
Now, the best homemade one was the two kitchen chairs and a sheet.
Made your own house.
Oh, man, you could make a fort. You could make a cabin, a cave.
Yeah, a rainy day plaything.
Oh, man. Well, not only the rainy day, you'd take them outside and put them in the backyard.
If I'd ever asked my mother, can I take this chair outside, she'd had a heart attack.
Oh, that was probably a good idea for Ma to get me out of the house.
Yeah.
But I thought I'd tell you that was the most interesting, fun thing was the lead-burning set.
Very good. You take care of yourself.
You have a good day.
Good to talk to you.
Bye-bye.
1-800-572-8255 is our number. Ludlow and Denny, and we are on the Fun Seekers Radio Network. And a quick reminder, Damask Rose is the latest exciting St. Martin's paperback by our friend Haywood Smith. You look for it at bookstores everywhere. 1-800-572-8255. Let's talk to Zane in Gadsden. Hello, Zane.
Good morning, Bud.
How you doing, Bud?
All right. I got something I hadn't heard this morning about the old wooden spools that Mama used to get her thread on.
Mm-hmm.
I used my caterpillar out of them.
You make them walk?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you know that, huh?
Yeah.
You run a rubber band through it, and on one end of it, you sort of cut a little notch, and you put that rubber band over a little stick, and you keep that end of it so it'll be stationary.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to cut notches in the rim of the spool.
Give them some traction.
Yeah. And then on the other end, we'd take a stick, I don't know, 4 or 5 inches long, and put the rubber band around that. And then we'd wind that rubber band up real tight. And between that stick and the spool, we'd put a little short piece of crayon to give it a little lubrication so it turns.
Mm-hmm. And grease that sucker right up.
Yeah, wind that sucker up, and it'd climb up a steep hill if you wound it up enough.
And you could spend hours fooling with it.
Oh, yeah. And when the rubber band broke, your biggest problem was finding another rubber band or cutting one out of an old inner tube.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons mamas didn't throw anything away.
Oh, no.
Because they ever threw a spool away, they were throwing a toy away, and same with the rubber band.
I've still got some of mother's old spools.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And some of them, I probably got at least a dozen of them.
You ever see
some of them with threads on them.
Ever see one used for a door handle?
Yeah.
I got to go, my man.
Many uses.
You take care of yourself. I'll talk to you. Bye-bye. 1-800-572-8255. We hadn't talked about kites either. I was a big kite flyer. Loved kites. And they could be homemade or bought, depending on your current financial situation. 1-800-572-8255. More right after this. Listen up, gang, because I'm going to tell you how to get the greenest lawn in your neighborhood. It's with Limerite from my friends at Georgia Marble, who understand our southern soil and know you got to have lime on that lawn to get that rich, full lawn that you want. Limerite from the folks at Georgia Marble. You stop by your favorite hardware store or nursery and pick some up. Ask for it by name. It is Limerite from my buddies at Georgia Marble Company. Gainesville, Georgia, and Coy on the radio. Hello, Coy.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is not my favorite toy, but it's my favorite toy Christmas story.
All right, good.
In 1952, my wife and I bought our two boys a Lionel train set. we put it on a plyboard, 4x8, and painted it, and we gave them a Lincoln log set.
Uh-huh.
Sometime that day, they made them a cabin right in the center of that, and we took a picture of it. About 2 or 3 years ago, my wife said, you ought to do something with that train. It was up in the attic. We moved it up the attic on that 4x8. So we got it down, and I put a shelf all the way around there steady, right under the door, and we put the train up, and it still works fine. We enlarged that picture of those two boys, and we took a piece of that plywood and put it in the corner, mounted in the corner of the room, and made that log cabin. Now, it's the same laws, obviously, we had to make it. And the boys had made a mistake. Instead of having one door and two windows in front, they had three doors. So we made three doors, and the thing runs perfect. And it's kind of a, you know, center of talk piece. And we still have the invoice and a book on it. And would you hazard a guess at what we paid for that with the engine? You know, it flashes the light and all that stuff. The complete set.
What, $29.95?
No, it was $59.95. And you know what those engines cost now?
What?
From 200 to 600. Just the itches. But this is, you know, it's very meaningful to us.
Yeah. Every time you look at it, the memories flood all over you.
That's right.
That's wonderful. You take care of yourself.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Cooper Weight Loss Center's gang helping you win the Battle of the Bulge. Call 770-952-7681 for more information. Let's go to Morrow, Georgia, WSSA, and my buddy Randy on the radio.
Tomorrow. Good morning, Ludlow.
How you doing, big fella?
Oh, I'm in great shape for the shape that I'm in. How you doing today, little buddy?
Doing good, doing good.
Hey, you were talking about piggy banks a little while ago.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of one that I had when I was a kid that I hated. Oh, I hated this bank. It was one of those metal cash register banks.
Yeah.
They would not open until it got to $10.
Oh, that puts you at a disadvantage.
Well, you got that right.
Yeah.
Mom had the key, of course. She could open it any time she wanted to, but do you think she did?
No.
No.
That'd be a special time.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
I read a story one time about a fella, or a lady, as a matter of fact, and I don't know how wise this is mechanically, but she got where she would put her change that she got back from wherever into the gas tank of her car. And when she got ready to sell the car, she had the gas tank taken off and had several hundred dollars in there. Had enough to take the gas tank off and buy her something else. It was a lot of money. I forget what it was.
Then she had to pressure wash the money, right?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know where you'd ever get the gasoline smell off your money.
I know that's right. Be a little difficult to spend. Well, I tell you that piggy bank I had, that thing would not register pennies, of course, and quarters were hard to come by for a kid at that, you know, back then. A dime was easy enough, but it'd take a lot of dimes to make that thing get to $10.
And then you would you decide that you couldn't live any longer without something, and you knew you had enough money to buy it, but your mama wouldn't give you the key.
Exactly. Exactly. I hated that thing.
She was trying to teach you to save and have a big bank account. Did it work?
No. Of course not. It was cruel and inhumane.
All that frustration, and didn't learn a thing. I understand.
Exactly. You have a good day, Lou.
All right, buddy. Stay in touch.
Sure, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Let's go to Mikisuki, Florida, and talk to my buddy, the Round Man.
Hey, Ludo, how you doing?
Fine, buddy.
Two things, the toys about marbles and them friction cars. The fella talking about the marbles brought back memories. My shooter, we called them the toy.
Toy, yeah.
That was my toy.
Yeah, mine too.
I'd win all the marbles, and then there was always a school ground or a new neighborhood shyster that would come and take my marbles back. Remember the ones that would have the little cigar box with the little hole?
Yeah.
And you'd hold the marble at your belt buckle, and if you could drop it through the hole, you'd get two for one.
Right.
He'd take all my marbles after I won them.
Yeah, he was the local hustler.
Right. The other thing, Mama would, back in the 40s, I'd say 46, 47, Mama would take me to downtown Bright Lights, two-story building, Tallahassee, Florida.
Wow.
To our shopping mall called McCrory's Five and Dime.
Yeah, the very best banana split in the world came from there.
And chicken salad sandwiches on toast.
Yeah.
About once a month, she'd give me a dime to buy a toy. And I'd get those little wind-up fiction push cars, you know, made out of metal.
Mm-hmm.
You'd push them on the floor, and they'd go, wooden, 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 and they'd go taking off like that. And like any little boy, Ludlow, after about an hour, I want to know what made it do that. And I turn it over, and on the bottom, there were little metal tabs. And you take a little screwdriver.
Straighten them out.
Yeah, and the top of the body would come off. And you know what they was made out of?
What?
Beer cans. This is, let me tell you, after World War II, everything that comes from Japan, whatever we left over there,
yeah,
they picked it up and sold it back to us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sort of deja vu in China.
Absolutely.
All right, Ludlow, enjoy it.
You take care, buddy. I'll talk to you. Hugh in Gadsden, Alabama. Hello, Hugh.
Hey, Luddy, just talking about kites. Did you ever make paste out of old flying water?
Yeah.
And get your old newspapers and briefly tell them how you made a kite.
You had to have the wood, which was usually the wood that came out of the bottom of a window shade because it was light, and you'd kind of make a cross out of that and just measure it to fit and glue all that stuff down so it had little pockets where all of those pieces of wood went and put a tail on it, and you were in business.
That's the way we made them.
Yep.
Except we'd use little pieces of slit or willer and sometimes little bamboo canes, you know. Yeah. That's fun, wasn't it?
All right, great fun. And you could spend a day doing that on a nice, bright, sunny day so you could get it to highs.
That's it. Have a good one, buddy.
All right, bud. Take care of yourself. More right after this.
Celebrating 50 years of service to Northeast Georgia, we're News Radio 960, WRFC, Athens.
72 degrees at 10:30. The official three-day forecast is coming up. Well, today brings divers back to Lake Lanier. Well, they'll resume the search for a scuba diver missing since Saturday. Police have not yet identified the 14-year-old who was feared drowned. They do say he was a certified diver and was not from Georgia. 40 divers were on Lake Lanier yesterday. Also, two police dogs. No sign of the missing teenager yesterday. Athens police are on the lookout for shooting suspects. A man identified as Greg Hall tells police he was shot in the arm while walking along Glenhaven Avenue early Sunday morning. Hall was not seriously injured in what police are now calling a drive-by shooting. No word yet on a motive for the gunplay. We learned today that more minorities are applying for admission to the University of Georgia. 1,200 last year, over 1,400 this year, despite concerns that anti-affirmative action sentiment in the Georgia General Assembly and elsewhere might drive those numbers down. And you can expect State Patrol checkpoints today in Clark County, elsewhere in the area later this week. The fourth wave of Operation Strap and Snap is underway, with troopers handing out more tickets for unbuckled motorists. They will also look for drivers who do not have their small children in child restraint safety seats. Checking stocks, the Dow is down 6 points, NASDAQ's down 5. News Radio 960, WRFC News Time, 10:31.
Are you an unpublished author? Do you have a book-length manuscript ready or almost ready for publication? Or do you know of anyone else who is an unpublished author?
I kept that thing all these years, and along about the middle 50s, my youngest son lost the front wheel off of it. And so I had it all these years. This spring I took it down to Cleveland Foundry, and the gentleman down there was really nice. And I said, he said, I'll try to make you one. And he made me one, almost a dead match to it. And so I put it on and painted it all up, and it really looks good.
All right.
But I wanted to tell you about, we didn't have much to amuse us out there. So Mother gave us an old chair we used for a workbench, and we had a pair of tin snips, a hammer, and a coping saw, and a saw, and a plane, and apple boxes, and tin snips.
Uh-huh.
And we made toys. Well, I made a 1935 Ford coupe, looked just like the real thing, about 14 inches long. I still have that. And we made little trucks. Of course, we liked stuff we could haul things in.
Yeah.
There weren't any 18-wheelers in there. We had made them.
Yeah.
But it had little trucks, little Rio trucks, Rio Speedwagon trucks, and little semis behind them.
It sounded like you were some pretty talented kids out there.
Oh, we had a ball. And there were four of us boys, and we had little farms out under the trees and made fences and little barns and things. But we really had it, and you know, kids that make things like that, they don't throw them away the next day.
No, it got too many man hours in them.
That's right, and your brothers and sisters better take care of them, too.
I'm glad you called, but you take care, Eldon.
Well, appreciate your show.
Talk to you soon, my friend. Let's go to Dallas, Georgia, where that no-account choo-choo man is ready. How you doing, big boy?
Hello, Ludlow.
What's going on?
Well, nothing much. I'm just enjoying the show. Luddy?
Yeah.
You've already talked about the bicycle and the little red wagon, but I got to tell you about mine. After you answer a trivia that's been worrying me to death over the weekend.
All right.
You know, there was three... out of all I want is three. There may have been more people in country music that you've heard records of, you know, that went on to be singing stars.
Mm-hmm.
That was governors of states. Name all three of them for me.
Well, of course, Jimmy Davis.
Yeah, you got that, New Orleans.
And I don't know whether this we could count...
Louisiana, rather.
Count Lester Maddox one or not.
That's the other one.
And we're one shy, aren't we?
Yes, Texas.
Who was it?
W. Leo Daniel, Light Crust Doughboys.
I didn't know that.
He went on to become... governor of Texas.
I didn't know that.
I figured you'd like that one.
Good one.
Now, I may have been the only child that ever had a trailer hitch on his bicycle.
What'd you haul?
Watermelons.
All
out
right.
of the watermelon patch.
All
with
right.
With my bicycle. I'd hook my red wagon behind the bicycle to that trailer hitch.
Uh-huh.
And I could carry three watermelons in that thing. And, man, I just sometimes if I hit a little boggy place, I'd have to get off and push.
Put it in four-wheel drive.
Well, I didn't have the four-wheel drive. I'd push till I'd get back on the level ground, and then I'd cut out.
Oh, buddy.
Yeah. Yeah, but that...
Where were you taking the watermelons?
Taking them to the house, putting them in the cellar.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, and we keep them things, you know, they'd be cool in the cellar.
Sure, yeah.
And a toy that I got that might have been the most exciting toy that I've ever seen was a little, one of these little Tommy guns. Or machine guns, I guess you call it.
Yeah.
That shoot sparks?
It did. It was a Dick Tracy machine gun.
That's what I had.
I had one, too. Shoot sparks. I had to wind that sucker up, and it'd shoot sparks for 4 inches.
We had a milk cow that wouldn't stay in the pasture.
Mm-hmm.
She'd tear that fence down and get out. Well, I got after her with that machine gun. Scared that cow to death. She never did get out of pasture again.
How long before she gave milk?
Well, I don't know. We may have missed some milk, too. But,
I expect.
But she knew where she lived, but she went back to the pasture, and she never did get out again.
Great story. Choo-choo, come see us.
Have a good one.
All right, buddy.
Bye-bye.
Let's go to Lowndes County, Georgia, and talk to Aubrey on the radio. Hello, Aubrey.
Well, hey, Ludlow.
How you doing, sunshine?
I can't begin to top any of them stories.
Well, you might want to try.
Ain't no use in trying.
All right.
So how was your weekend, Ludlow?
You fine? Yours all right?
Yeah, it was okay.
Good.
I used to like the trains and race car tracks. But I always noticed on the race car tracks, one car was always slower than the other one.
I think one was faster than the other one.
Well, yeah, that too. But it didn't matter what side of the track you put the other one on, it's still slower.
Uh-huh, okay.
So you always wanted to get the car that was faster.
but if it was your toy, then you knew which one.
Exactly.
Yeah.
My brother Maurice used to have one of those things. But I got a train today. I just keep it up in the closet.
Yeah.
It's battery operated. It's got a train station, and then I built a little tunnel for it.
How long you had it, Aubrey?
Oh, just probably close to 10 years.
All right.
I don't ever use it. I just keep it on display, basically. And I got a, like, thing built, cities built behind it with skyscrapers. You know?
That sounds fun.
I got it decorated pretty good.
Sounds fun.
Well, man, I'm enjoying the show and getting educated at the same time.
All right, bud, you keep listening. We love it.
Talk to you later.
Talk to you. Bye-bye. 1-800-572-8255 is our number. Our good friend, you've heard her on this show many, many times, our good friend Haywood Smith is right now got a brand new book out. It's a Scottish historical novel, and it's going to be in bookstores all over any day. Matter of fact, it's probably there now. This best book yet is called, and she is burning up the bushes with these things, selected by Romantic Times magazine, is one of May's five top picks for Barnes & Noble. It's on its recommended reading list. You've heard her here many times, and you're going to hear her here again. A really talented writer. It's called Damask Rose, this brand new one, by Haywood Smith. You remember Secrets in Satin. And
chapters 1 through 15. Fly paper, penny loafers, Lucky Strike cream. Flat tops, sock tops, Studebaker, Pepsi, please. Do you remember these? Cigar bands on your hand, your daddy's socks roll down. Sticks, no plugs, and aviator caps with flaps that button down. Movie stars on Dixie Cup tops.
Oh, yeah. 1-800-572-8255. As we go to Madison, Georgia, and talk to Radio Ray, formerly known as Radio Virgil. How you doing, Ray?
Doing fine. How are you?
I'm doing good.
And how are you doing?
I'm still doing good. Nothing has changed.
Where'd you come in with this radio, formerly Virgil?
Well, that's what I heard, that your name used to be Virgil.
Well, I'm not going to ask you who told you.
And you changed. Denny told me.
Denny told me.
Yeah, and
I'm
said,
not gonna argue with him.
I said, how you know? And he said, you can look at him and tell.
Okay.
So, do you mind if we call you Verge?
No, hey, you know, whatever you want to call me is fine with me.
Okay.
Because everybody else does.
Okay.
Okay, so Verge, Radio Verge will be okay.
Radio Verge, we'll try that for a while, see if it rings.
Okay. Well, talk about favorite toys. One of my favorite toys that I've always used to like back when I was growing up was I might be kind of like showing the macho side of myself.
Yeah.
Was the G.I. Joe action figure.
All right. All right.
Yes. I don't know why, but I've just always used to like that.
Well, that was a very popular toy.
Yeah. And I used to ask for G.I. Joe action figure every time back when I was growing up, back in my younger days.
Mm-hmm.
I used to like the G.I. Joe action figure.
Well, that thing came with guns and everything.
Yeah. You go bang, bang, and play with them.
You know what Denny just put on the screen?
What?
We may be on to something here. This could be the start of something big for you.
Oh, really?
Says you need to get into TV.
Uh-huh.
Then we could call you Video Virgil. In addition to playing with dolls, what other favorite toys did you have?
are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
The little toy gun belts that they used to make and had little guns in them?
Yeah.
Cap guns?
Cap busters.
Yeah.
Sure I do, yeah.
Yeah, I used to like to play with those, too.
Well, every little boy did.
Used to like to put that little gun belt on, because I felt at the time that it made me feel like a big person,
Used to call your mama Pilgrim, right?
Yeah.
Hello,
hey.
Pilgrim.
Hello, Pilgrim.
Yeah, I love it.
pour that cap gun out. Bang, bang, bang,
Yeah.
go run outside the yard, run around the house and hide around the corner of the house and look around. Bang, 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 pretend like I'm shooting.
Yeah. Yeah, and if you couldn't find a gun, use a stick.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So those probably two of my favorites when I was back, and I always have to emphasize this, back in my younger...
I realize that you don't still play with cap pistols. You don't have to tell me.
And matter of fact, Christine is standing right here at the door, our wonderful, lovely secretary.
More than lovely.
Yeah, more than lovely.
More than
lovely. Yeah, she's standing right here at the door, and she's pointing her finger like bang, bang, bang.
Uh-huh.
So, see, she's got nothing better to do.
What you're supposed to say is... I got you first.
Oh, okay, I got you first. Bang, I got you first. Okay, now she's pretending like she's been shot.
Okay. You know, working with you must be like working with a flock of pigeons.
Hey, you know, now I think I'm going to go find Jim and go, bang, bang, you're dead.
That's right. That's right. Exactly right.
And maybe, you know, Jim... when he's not working here, he's involved in, like, doing engraving for guns and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to see if he'll engrave my fingers.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good. All right, big boy.
I'll let you know how it comes out.
Do that. I'm glad to talk to you always.
Well, listen, let me tell you something. Later on this week when I talk to you, I've got a great idea to come up with some racing activities. Like car racing and so forth.
You mean real stuff or toys?
No, real stuff. No, this is real stuff. The stuff I've been writing down today. But see, this past weekend I went to the racing action up in Brazelton, Georgia.
Uh-huh.
And I came up with some great ideas for some wackos to get together to have some grudge matches.
Grudge matches?
Yeah, like racing grudge matches.
You got any idea what day you might drop this on us?
Well, I'm going to find out, see what day you're going to maybe have like a kind of open topic or something.
Okay.
Like that.
Yeah. Boy, listen, the electricity is running through this studio. Right this minute.
Hey, I can feel it. I can hear it in your voice.
Yeah, Denny says, try to work on this. Figure out a way to combine wrestling and car racing.
Ooh. Ooh.
Go 200 miles
and
have a fist fight at the end.
Wow, hey, that'd be an idea.
And you know who could have the checkered flag?
Who?
Jerry Springer.
Hey, you got an idea there.
And he had two lesbians in a fist fight as they crossed the finish line.
Hey, I like that idea. We'll have to work on that. One other thing.
All right.
Denny said that he was going to try to, like, fax me some information about, movie scripts that he wants me to do on the radio.
Oh, really?
Yes, uh-huh. And I still haven't got to be.
I'll remind him.
Okay, thank you.
You take care of your bad self.
Hey, listen, you all have a great Monday, okay?
We're gonna do that. What did you do this weekend?
Well, I was busy this weekend.
Good.
Yeah, I went to cover some news stories over the weekend.
All right, good. Very, very good. I'm glad to know you're on the job.
Yeah, hey, always.
You take care.
Okay, you
talk
too.
Talk to you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
1-800-572-8255 is our number. Ludlow and Denny, the Fun Seekers Radio Network. AirTran gang, the airline that's turning air travel you can afford into air travel you can actually enjoy, announces a brand new destination. Start May 18th. You stop paying high fares for the convenience of flying nonstop from a...
In, but there was a weed with a thick stalk that was hollow in the middle.
Yeah.
And that's what we used for the wood part of the kite.
Very light, yeah.
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 And I wrote all this down, how to do it, because, you know, it's a lost art making these toys. And if you don't know how to make them, you don't really have a choice. You have to buy from the toy manufacturer.
Right.
So I wrote it down for my niece and nephew. And then the next time I visited with them, I showed them how to do it. And we took it out. And it wouldn't fly. It was too heavy. I think I used, if I shortened the tail, maybe.
Yeah, you have to. Sometimes you have to keep fooling with that tail, depending on the wind.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, sometimes you get it too long, too short, you know, that sort of thing. Yeah, I remember those days.
That was down in Augusta. There may not have been enough wind. I mean, a few years ago when I tried to repeat it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you write all these things down, these toys and how to make them, write that in, put it in a book, I wonder if it'd sell. I think it would be valuable.
Well, it would be a piece of nostalgia, and it probably would sell if it was well done, and you hit the heart of the matter, like the kites and the rubber guns and the what we used to call soapbox racers and that sort of thing. You remember those? Make your own car?
I remember seeing them.
Yeah.
But I didn't make them. That was sort of a boy thing, wasn't it?
Yeah, pretty much.
I remember slingshots, making those from, you know, you have to select just the right piece of wood, preferably cedar.
Right.
And the old inner tube, you know, cutting that for the slingshot.
Yeah, the way, when the inner tubes went away, so did the slingshots.
Yeah.
Yeah, gone forever. I'm glad you called, my love.
Thank you.
You take care of yourself.
You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I remember the Balt kites, and I hope they're still this way, were very patriotic. A lot of red, white, and blue, a lot of stars, a lot of flags, a lot of characters from history, that sort of thing. Limelight gang for the greenest lawn in your neighborhood. Let's go to Rome, Georgia, and talk to the Rome wild man. How you doing?
Good morning, Ludlow.
You behaving yourself?
Well, pretty much have to.
Good.
Now, you know, nowadays we don't have all of the government back in a few, or rather a few years ago, we didn't have all the government protection and all the disclaimers and everything.
And we were free to put our eyes out with BB guns if we wanted.
Yeah. Now then, I understand that these Superman capes have a warning that... says this cape, wearing this cape, does not enable you to fly.
Mm-hmm. What a shocker.
Well, I never was deprived. I always had my Tinker Toys and Lincoln Logs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I wanted a pedal car, and for some reason or another, never had one.
You know, I never had one either that I remember.
Well, anyway, when my kid came along, I thought, now, he's going to have one of those things. So I bought the most pretty, this little Stutz Bearcat you've ever seen. Didn't even have to assemble it. It came out of the box. And, you know, the Stutz Bearcat, old antique automobile.
Yeah, I remember the Stutz Bearcat.
Well, he saw that thing, and the box came in, and he went right for the box. And it was a couple of years before he was playing with that thing.
I bet everybody could tell a story just like that, that threw the toy away and loved the box for 5 years.
Come to think of it, I think I always enjoy the box.
Yeah. You take care of your bad self.
I'll do my best.
Got to get out of here.
Okay, boy. Bye-bye.
Toys, your favorite toys you didn't have to buy, like a Prince Albert can or a Brenda Starr paper doll. We'll be right back.
Celebrating 50 years of service to Northeast Georgia, we're News Radio 960, WRFC, Athens.
Athens Tourism Week, Chuck Jones is the Bureau Director.
A lot of people don't realize that we have year-round tourism. Even our local residents, I think, oftentimes just associate tourism with University of Georgia football games. And, of course, there is much more to the tourism product in Athens.
Georgia's Department of Industry, Trade, and Tourism says Athens tourism was a $161 million industry in 1997. Well, search resumes this morning for a missing scuba diver. The 14-year-old disappeared Saturday on Lake Lanier. Divers from Hall County joined the recovery efforts later today. 40 divers and two search dogs were on the lake yesterday. More members of minorities are trying to get into the University of Georgia, just over 1,200 last year, more than 1,400 so far this year. Many had worried about a possible decrease in minority applications, with Georgia lawmakers and others becoming more vocal in their opposition to affirmative action. Search continues for a suspect in last week's attack at the University of Georgia's Cresswell Hall. A fifth-floor resident says she was choked by a man who entered her room, then fled after she screamed. While the victim was not seriously injured, the incident has raised concerns over safety at the dorm. Many students are saying it's too easy for non-residents to enter the building. Well, you better buckle up. State troopers will be setting up checkpoints today in Athens and in Clark County, kicking off another one of those strap and snap campaigns. They will be writing tickets for unbuckled drivers. And the 11th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals convenes today. And
are singing, and I hope you are enjoying yourself. Been talking about toys, we'll continue with that, or we will add to it. And anytime you start talking about toys, you get into children's adventures. And we've heard some of those today. You get talking about the haircuts and the fact that all little children get involved in this, either as the barber or the victim at one time or another. Cut your sister's hair, cut your brother's hair. Always has to be a younger sibling, because an older one would not stand still for this. And I mean, in the literal term, would not stand still for this. So we can talk about some of your adventures as a child and some of the things that we were allowed to do that I guess we were warned about these things, but we were big cave diggers. And you know, if my children had said they wanted to go out and dig a cave, my first thought is it's going to cave in and they're all going to be dead. But they never did seem to cave in. And relatively safe. We dug a lot of caves in a lot of different places, and it was great fun. I remember it as being great fun. And part of the fun was you never let the smaller children in. You remember that? Smaller children never got, no matter how hard they worked, they were never rewarded with pre-entry to the cave. You normally had to crawl in because we didn't have anything except picks and shovels. Fun stuff, and we always get back to those. And then I have something else here I want to do a little bit of today. I have got what is referred to in the headline above it is the world's simplest quiz. The world's simplest quiz, and it's got about 15 questions here that are very, very interesting. And if somebody wants to call and take a shot at the world's simplest quiz, we'll give you a refrigerator magnet or something if you get one of the answers right. But let me just tell you that this is not the world's simplest quiz. It sounds simple on the face of it, but it's just very difficult. So we can do some of that now if you'd like to, or we can put that off to another time when we're devoting a whole day to trivia. I've just got it here. If you want to play a little bit of the world's simplest quiz and see if you can win a refrigerator magnet, we'll add that to the topic on this Monday. Going to be a great week, and we hope that you are going to be around. We're going to be talking tomorrow about, at least for one of the hours, about Medicare and Medicaid and what all that is. We read about them fussing and fighting about this, and we hear advertising about what you ought to buy, what you ought to have. We're gonna have an expert in here tomorrow, and we're going to see what we can learn about Medicare and Medicaid, exactly what it is and what does it do, and when we all reach that age someday, what it will do for us, or in some cases, what it will not do for us. How valuable is it, and what are the details? And also maybe some problems that you're having with it we can get to the bottom of. So that will be tomorrow, and we encourage you to stay tuned. Right now we're going to get back to our toy discussion. Mention the kites. I found, while we did make some sometimes just for fun, kites, pretty cheap when I was a little boy, and I think a dime you could buy. I don't know how they could possibly afford to make those things for a dime, but they did. And if you could pick your place where there were no trees, no wires, one of those things could last you an entire summer. And great, great fun. And then your next biggest expense, when you really got good at that, your next biggest expense was the string, the kite string. And everybody had their own ball of kite. Even when the kite was gone, you saved that string. And it was not impossible to have 400 or 500 feet of string laying around your house waiting for a good windy day. We can talk about all of that and conjure up some more memories. Here's the way you get in here. 1-800-572-8255. That's 1-800-572-TALK. We'll be right back. Now, you know, when you get to be... All right, M-I-C-K-E-Y, Dalton, Georgia, where Fred is anchored in, standing by. Hello, Fred.
Hey, Luddy.
How you doing, bud?
You remember me? I got through to you once before, and we told each other some talking dog stories.
Okay.
I want to talk about some toys.
All right.
I'm 84 years old.
Yes, sir.
But back when I was about 12, we had 4th of July, they would sell these little handguns. I guess they were just cast metal. They had two sizes. You could buy one for a quarter and a bigger size that looked just like a detective snub-nosed 38.
Yeah.
For 50 cents.
Uh-huh.
And that shot a blank 22 cartridge. And you'd break the barrel down. You'd just bend the barrel down. It was a single shot. Well, us kids, there was about a half a dozen of us roughneck boys. We'd get those darn guns. We'd go to the dump and find leather and boots and cut them up and make holsters and bullet belts and so on. And then we'd choose upside. Just like in the Cowboys, we had our carbines and our six-shooter.
Cowboys and bad guys. Indian, Jim.
The old Daisy air rifle, you know, lever cock. Back in those days, that's over 70 years ago, those old Daisy rifles, they didn't have too much power, you know. And we'd choose upsides, and we'd get up in the woods and the hills and shoot at each other, you know, really have a battle. And even if you hit somebody still 11, we could have put somebody's eye out and so on.
Yeah, because that's what your parents always warned you about. You're going to put somebody's eye out.
Right.
Yeah.
But then one smart aleck on one of our battles had the bright idea to take a BB from his air rifle and drop it down the barrel of this gun that was shooting a 22 blank. And damned if he didn't hit one of the other guys right in the chest. And boy, he yelled, "I'm hit, I'm wounded." And we thought he was kidding.
Yeah.
We went over till we saw the blood on his shirt. And we were all panicked then. But we grabbed the kid and we carried him practically about a half a mile to get to the doctor, the hospital. And of course, when we got there, they said it was a gunshot wound. Boy, they had him in there. It actually punctured his lung.
Wow.
And after this was all over, our local sheriff, we only had about two policemen in the whole area, came around and confiscated all of our guns.
Boy, that is scary.
It is. But
you knew it had to happen.
In our little old town, we had a weekly newspaper. You know, one of these kind of little, comes out once a week.
Yeah.
And they had a big article in there. And the crowning touch of this article, it explained what I just described to you. But the crowning touch in that article, it says, the kid's name was Foster. Says Foster, in spite of his wounds, beat his companions to the hospital. Oh. Hell, we lugged him, dragged him.
That's funny. I'm glad you called, big boy. You take care.
My hind end really got it for a couple of weeks.
Funny. Take care of yourself. I'll talk to you. Frosty Mountain, pure spring water, gang. That is water from the spring, not the tap, and it's available at fine stores everywhere. Let's go to Newnan and talk to the Humor Man. Hello, Humor Man.
Ludlow.
How you doing?
I'm doing well. I hope you are.
I am wide open today, buddy.
You're a treasure of humor, and I'm addicted to you. I listen to you all the time.
Bless you.
I read a little item the other day that you'll find interesting, goes along with what we're talking about. A young man in Modesto, California, was arrested for attempting to hold up a branch bank without a weapon. He was using his thumb and his finger to simulate a gun, but he forgot to keep his hand in his pocket. Now,
the question I have to ask, is that legally, is that armed robbery?
I don't know what. It's finger robbery. I don't know what it is. But I could sympathize with him because that was the same kind of weapon I used when I was a little boy.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't let me use anything else, and I couldn't hold up the neighborhood children, couldn't hold them off either.
That is so funny. Nobody was afraid of your finger.
Exactly, but my mother ended it all. She saw me one time coming around the house with pointing my finger at the children. She said, "Son, don't point your finger, it's impolite." My dear mother, bless her. She ended it all for me right there.
Bless her heart. Your career as a gunman was over.
It was over.
I love it. You take care.
Thanks a lot.
I'll talk to you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Don't point. It's impolite. And the poor idiot in Modesto, that ought to give him a few years just for being dumb. Give me your money or I'll shoot you with my finger. It's all cocked. 1-800-572-8255. We'll be right back.
Yes, you all recognize Take Me Out to the Ball Game from baseball's musical legacy. And it's just one of many musical masterpieces you'll receive absolutely free just for coming to a Braves game. This audio avalanche is not available in any store, so call Ticketmaster at 404-249-6400 or 800-326-4000 or buy tickets at Turner Field. Remember, you get baseball's musical legacy plus the greatest baseball team of the 90s just for buying Braves tickets now. Call today.
Listen up, gang, because I'm going to tell you how to get the greenest lawn in your neighborhood. It's with Limerite from my friends at Georgia Marble, who understand our southern soil and know you got to have lime on that lawn to get that rich, full lawn that you want. Limerite from the folks at Georgia Marble. You stop by your favorite hardware store or nursery and pick some up. Ask for it by name. It is Limerite from my buddies at Georgia Marble Company.
This is News Radio 960 WRFC. Since 1948, we've been a part of the Classic City, bringing you the most complete coverage of Athens, Northeast Georgia, the nation, and the world.
I, Jimmy Carter, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
Idol of millions, Elvis Presley died in August of a heart condition.
Reasons for recommended dismissal of James O. Baker include conduct.
The Cessna 150 slammed into the White House grounds.
I can confirm that the President has been shot.
As of now, I am in control here in the White House.
Jimmy Hoffa probably was kidnapped or killed.
Thousands of people are here at the wall. They're climbing it, chipping away at it.
Read my lips.
It has been an honor and a privilege to come into your homes all these years and entertain you.
2 hours ago, Allied Air Forces began an attack on military targets in Iraq and Kuwait.
50 years old and new every day. This is News Radio 960 WRFC.
Hi, gang, this is Ludlow Porch, and if you're not listening to the Fun Seekers Network, just see what you're missing. Join me weekdays, 10 to noon, on News Radio 960, the new WRFC.
Weekend comes, knocking on the door, pitter-patter little feet running on the floor, turning on the lights, making sure that I can see. Tugging on the sheets, ain't no way that I can sleep, say. Grandpa, what's your plan for the day? What about fishing or a baseball game? I've been wishing for some money for the ice cream man. Come on, Grandpa, what you got planned?
All right, 1-800-572-8255, Cleveland, Tennessee. And the cleaning babe is on.
Good morning to you, Ludlow.
Hello, beautiful lady. How you feel?
I feel much better.
Good.
Just a weekend in the wilderness, I guess, is all I needed.
That's exactly what you
cleared
need.
Cleared out those sinuses. Wow.
Well, good.
I was going to tell you a funny thing, and even my husband on the way home from camping said, well, you got a good one to call into Ludlow on Monday. One of my nephews, my husband's brother, Ken, came up with us with his two young kids.
Mm-hmm.
2 and 4, okay?
Mm-hmm.
These kids wrestle from the time they wake up till the time after they go to bed. I mean, they just wrestle constantly, two little boys. And they spent most of the time there on the air mattress in the tent because it was real bouncy, you
mm-hmm.
know? But anyway, I was going to say that the best toys, they brought some toys with them, but they spent the whole time playing with sticks and rocks, you know? And the funniest thing that happened was we went to bed Friday night, and then Saturday morning I had to get up early as usual because I drink so much water and make my way to the campground bathroom, you know, and I tried to be quiet. Went back in our tent, and my brother-in-law heard us talking in his tent, so he thought we were outside. So he unzipped his tent and came on out, and evidently that was just enough to wake up the 2-year-old, Austin. And you could just hear everything, like a pin drop in there. We could sound like we were right, you know, next to each other, which we were, but I mean like we were in the same tent. And he asked his dad if he could come on out now, and his dad said, yeah, get your shoes on, you can come out. And then it was quiet for a minute, and Austin said, Daddy, somebody turned on the lights. Because, I mean, it was about 6:30, 6:45, bright daylight. And I was laying on my mattress next door, and I said, Austin, God turned on the lights. What was he thinking about turning the lights on this early? But he was awake and raring to go because somebody turned on the lights.
That's funny. You knew it was time to get up.
It was time to get up, and when he went to bed, it was pitch dark. And they wrestled and carried on the whole time. And they're ready to go back camping again.
Oh, yeah.
It was really nice.
Are you ready to go back, or you want to
And some of the folks that went with us heard me and really ragged me about it when they heard me say Friday that it was my husband that loves to camp. But he's known this for 20 years. He tried to get me interested in camping, from the time we've been married.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun at times, but it has to be just the right weather for me. It was too hot for a fire. And if you don't have a campfire, then but I will say that it cooled down quite a bit Friday night, and we did have a fire. And he said, well, you got your fire now.
Yeah, fire's pretty much part of it.
You have to have it. You have to have it. But anyway, I was going to get you to ask me one of those quiz questions just to break the ice in case everybody else was too chicken to do it.
Would you like to have one?
I don't mind making a fool of myself. I've done it a lot on this program.
How long did the 100 Years War last?
100 years?
116 years.
Okay. I think I've seen this somewhere before.
Yeah, that's... That kind of sets the tone for all of it, yeah.
You have to kind of know it if you know it. My opinion of the best toy is a brother or sister, and preferably a passel of brothers and sisters.
Yeah, and you had a passel, didn't you?
Yeah, because we could do anything. We could be everything from a congregation to a wrecking crew. Mm-hmm. It didn't matter, you know.
Yeah, to a band of cowboys.
Yeah, and we always got to fight about who was going to get to be the... Because the Indians didn't ride horses. They only had to sneak behind trees and stuff.
Well, that's not fair.
No, it's not. And only the cowboys got to have the broom handles and have horses and stuff and flap their thighs, you know, and make that galloping sound.
And do a giddy-up, yeah.
Yeah. And, oh, man. But anyway, I was going to tell you one last thing. But when my girls were probably five and two or three, we lived in a house not far from where we live now, but there was one section of the grass that for some reason the yard was all fenced in and they just played out in it all day long. And for some reason, one little section had not been mowed, and it was pretty high to them. I mean, you know, it was probably a foot high at least.
Yeah.
It was really weeds and tall grass. So they decided to tromp down sections and make rooms. They made a house in there, you know, and they had a room for everything in the house. And I just was, you know, had the windows open so I could listen to them and keep an eye on them. And I heard Jennifer holler, Sarah! Where are you? And Sarah says, I'm in the kitchen. Which was another little section of grass that was tromped down.
Oh,
but I thought, well, you know, kids will not be bored, like you've said 100 times.
They really won't. If there's nothing to play with...
You tromp some grass down. You've got a house. And talk about the sheet and the chairs thing,
yeah.
And the blankets and cushions. I don't know how many times that saved my life with my girls when it was raining or something outside.
Yeah.
They'd have caves and rooms and, you know, they just loved it.
They will not be bored, and I don't care whether it's in the back seat of a car. What can I do fun? I know I'll make my little sister scream.
Yeah. She's touching me. Don't look at me. He's looking at me.
Yeah. He looked at me, Daddy.
We went through that. You should try having six kids and everybody wants to sit by the window.
Yeah.
That's the reason we had a station wagon, not for the room, but because there was windows all around the back.
More windows, yeah.
That's right, exactly.
Good stuff. I'm glad you called.
I'm glad to talk to you.
Glad you're feeling better. And I'm glad you're home.
Okay, bye-bye.
Take care, bye-bye. AirTran Airlines, gang, it's something else. We'll be right back.
We have no need to call the road. When we get to the vision hole, there'll be you, me, and old dog Trey to doodle time away. If we don't hook a perch or bass, we'll cool our toes in dewy grass, or else pull up a weed to chaw and maybe set and jaw. Watching that hound, a scratching at his flea. Come on, take down your fishing pole and meet me at the fishing hole. I can't think of a better way to pass the time of day.
Celebrating 50 years of service to Northeast Georgia, we're News Radio 960, WRFC, Athens.
Good morning. morning. I'm Beth Larson with an information update on News Radio 960 WRFC. 74 degrees at 11:30. Your official three-day forecast is coming up. And checking stocks at this hour, the Dow is down 14 points. NASDAQ's down 10. News Radio 960 WRFC News Time, 11:31.
Have you ever heard a sweeter sound than the sound of a well-hit golf ball? Maybe it's the sound of the money going in the cash register of a golf course owner. The Renaissance Group is offering the opportunity of a lifetime with their new indoor virtual reality golf. Players can select 10 top PGA golf courses, 24 hours a day, rain or shine, and you pocket the greens fee. There's nothing to sell or stock, and you can be your own boss. Virtual reality golf is the wave of the future. If you're looking for a sound investment to add to your retirement income or to add to your present income, we urge you to call and inquire about this limited opportunity. Call and our representatives will rush you a portfolio and free video. There's a minimum investment of $39,500. Call 1-800-216-2562. But call now, today. 1-800-216-2562. You're never too old to own 10 PGA golf courses. 1-800-216-2562.
More with Ludlow Porch is just ahead, but first, a look at your official three-day forecast. Calling for partly sunny skies today, high in the upper 80s. Clear skies tonight with a low in the upper 50s. For tomorrow, sunny skies, high in the upper 80s. And on Wednesday, partly sunny skies with high once again in the upper 80s. Currently, we have partly sunny skies and 74 degrees on South Millage Avenue in Athens. I'm Beth Larson, and you're up to date at 11:32. More news in less than 30 minutes and bulletins at once from News Radio 960, WRFC.
Buddy, crystal clear. Good morning, Crystal.
Good morning, Mr. Port.
How are you, my love?
I'm pretty good.
Good.
I was listening to Cleaning Lady, and like she must have grown up in my neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
She really brings back lots of neat memories.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not really as old as her, probably, but I'm very advanced for my times.
Yeah.
And so some of these things I really remember. And, you know, one of the things I remember we used to do is we used to take jump ropes and we'd put them in between our mouths, and one of us would be the horse and the other would, you know, holler and the horse would pull away.
And you walk along behind the one with the rope in his mouth?
Right. And and like the other horse, he'd be pulling and pulling because he was Fury.
Mm-hmm.
You remember Fury?
I do remember Fury.
And the story of Joey, the boy who loved him.
Mm-hmm.
And don't tell me Joey wore a wig.
No.
Okay. But anyway, we used to play Fury.
But Fury did wear a wig.
Oh, no.
Oh, that's all right.
I heard he was dyed.
Yeah.
That was terrible.
It was terrible.
But anyway, we used to play Fury, and like, all of us had overbites, you know, because of pulling on those ropes. And then the other thing, you know, Mean Brothers.
Uh-huh.
My brother used to take those friction cars.
Yeah.
And chase me around.
Uh-huh.
And put them in my hair.
Uh-huh.
And, like, I had those punk hairdos way ahead of time.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, I went around like that with my hair real short up top and long on the bottom.
Yeah.
And he used to do that to me. And he used to take those purple berries that get all over the horses and cows.
Yeah.
And he would squish them,
mm-hmm,
and said they were poison and try to make me eat them.
Mm-hmm.
And that big brother, he turned into a Methodist minister, you know?
Did he really?
You'd think he'd be a lawyer.
You know? Or a horse trainer.
Right. And so that was something he liked to do. And but you know what I like to do most of all now?
What's that?
Okay, I'm a grandma. I know it doesn't seem possible.
No,
but
that's really hard to believe.
It is hard to believe. But I go to these big clubs where you buy lots of stuff at one time.
Yeah.
And we got, like, you know, 2,000 rolls of toilet paper.
Uh-huh.
And my grandson and I, we make castles. You know, you got the four packs.
Uh-huh.
And you can stack them on top of each. And we fill up, we make a whole castle in the living room.
Yeah.
And then my 11-year-old grandson will come by and
play Big Bad Wolf for the three-year-olds.
The Huff and Puff?
Yes, and like they have more fun just blowing down toilet paper castles. and so, you know, you can still make toys.
Yeah, it is.
And like if I want to drive my daughter crazy, I'll take one of those big five-pound cans of coffee, you know, and fill it with marbles, one of those, you know, tin cans of marbles, and we play marching band, and, you know, that drives her crazy. And these are fun things grandmas can do.
Yeah, and then give them the cans and the marbles.
So you take this home and play with it.
That's right, enjoy it.
And enjoy it. And that, you know, that's just one of the things. And the best toy for this Christmas, you know how expensive those Brio and Thomas Tank trains are? Very, very, the tunnels are like $80.
Mm-hmm.
We make them out of styrofoam that you get in the VCR boxes and stuff.
Yeah.
We make tunnels, and we made the best tunnels out of that styrofoam. And he, you know, we just make our own shapes and all, and my grandson thought I was, like, really smart.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't know how long that'll last. Usually it wears off pretty quick.
No, I think...
People thinking I'm smart, but, you know, it's fun now.
I think with a grandma like you, it would have to be wonderful. Have you taught them how to play Fury yet with the rope in their mouth?
Not yet, but, you know, we're working up to that. You know, it's hard to find a good rope. Now they're plastic ropes. I don't know how that'll work.
No, that's not going to work good at all.
No, it used to be that hemp stuff or something. You could chew on it, you know, and you would, and oh, it's sad when they tore.
And make your...
We did have strong teeth.
And jaws, I would imagine.
Yes.
Did you have any method of deciding who was going to be the horse and who was going to hold the other end of the rope?
The bigger kid.
Bigger kids.
Was the rider, and the littler kid was the horse, whoever happened to be playing with at the time.
Well, if you decide you want to do that with your grandchildren, we'd like to come up and do a remote from there. I'd really like to see that. That'd be a first.
That would be. But didn't you used to do that?
No. Oh. Nobody got to play the horse. We had people who were the bad guys and the good guys and the cowboys and the Indians, but nobody got to be the horse.
And then you try to make her jump over the sawhorses, you know, that your dad had, you know, and it's kind of fun too. But we were mean. Were you mean when you were growing up?
I think probably we had that mean streak that a lot of children have, hair cutting and that sort of thing.
Because like my big brother was mean to me, so and then I would be mean to my little brother.
I passed it along.
Right, you had to, but I heard your little brother was mean.
How mean was he?
Well, I heard that you all had a squirrel.
Mm-hmm.
And he used to take this little boy that we know and make him put his finger in the cage to see if the squirrel would bite it.
Uh-huh.
And I heard about that.
Terrible. Just terrible.
Yeah, this guy, he told me this.
Crystal, I hope you have the best day of your life. You are wild as a March hare, and we love it. Call us soon.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All had overbites, didn't he? 1-800-572-8255 is our number. Toys. Most favorite. Which one did you love the most? Did you make it? Or was it, did it come from the toy store? Or wherever toys come from, I guess hardware stores at some point. Our number, 1-800-572-8255. It is absolutely a great day to be alive. Hope you're going to enjoy this weather. And the last thing I heard, there was no R word in the forecast. No rain on the way. And that suits me just fine. Bet it suits you. Ludlow and Denny, the Fun Seekers Radio Network. Toll-free call, 1-800-572-8255. That's 1-800-572-TALK. AirTran gang, the airline that's turning air travel you can afford and the air travel you can actually enjoy. Brand new destination starting May 18th. By golly, I think that's today, isn't it? You can stop paying high fares for the convenience of flying nonstop from Atlanta to Hartford, Connecticut. That's right. You can fly straight to Hartford's Bradley International Airport at a special introductory fare of just $99 one way. And that's with no advance purchase required. That's for every coach seat on every flight to Hartford through June 17th, 1998. And at just $99 one way, it is a very civilized way to save. For reservations to Hartford or to any of AirTran's great destinations, you call your travel agent or you call my friends at AirTran Airlines, 770-994-8258. 770-994-8258. That's AirTran Airlines, gang. It's something else.
Sports Talk 960.
Hit it. It's time to bring in our legal expert, Professor Ron Carlson.
This Latrell Sprewell business, the judge put in a gag order. He did not want to have another OJ case. Spree himself referenced OJ in talking about this. He said, hey, I'm not like OJ. I didn't kill two people. And indeed, he did not. He just rearranged the coach's windpipe a little.
Sports Talk 960 on News Radio 960, the new WRFC.
Liberty Mutual Insurance attracts thousands of new business customers every year because with us, they can expect to get sound safety advice and responsive claim service, which means doing our job helps people stay on the job. Liberty Mutual, helping people live safer, more secure lives.
That's the freedom of liberty.
For a down-home good time, join me, Ludlow Porch, weekdays 10 to noon on News Radio 960, the new WRFC.
Christopher Robin and I walked along under branches lit up by the moon. Posing our questions to owl and the oar as our days disappeared all too soon. Than I should, and I can't find my way to the 3-acre wood, so help me.
All right, Barnwell, South Carolina, and Ann. Good morning, Ann.
I came along during the Depression, I suppose, and my mother made most of our clothes, and she was always finding ways to make toys for with the spools that the thread came on.
Right.
And my brother, and I don't think anybody's mentioned this morning, but my brother would take the spool and somehow or other notch out, you know, the ends of it, you know, the rims.
Yeah.
And put a rubber band in, or I don't think it was rubber bands in, a piece of inner tube or something, twist it up tight, put a little stick in each end, and it would roll along. And it was his tractor or
tank or whatever he wanted it to be.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But we had a lot of those rolling around.
I'm afraid when they stopped using the wooden spools and went to the plastic, I'm afraid they killed off a lot of great toys.
They surely did. And I've saved a few just in case.
You know what you can do?
What's that?
You can still give them to your children or your grandchildren or neighbors.
Great-grandchildren.
Yeah, and let them put that down in a little bowl of soap suds and extend. Still blow bubbles. Even
right.
With,
we
even
did
with
that
the,
with them, too,
yeah.
Right. And another thing, I lived in a community that we had a lot of big oak trees, and most of the roots were, you know, up on top of the ground.
Right.
And that was my house. Each room, between each set of roots was my house. And I picked these little tiny bitter flowers that look like they have yellow in the middle and white around. I'm
yeah.
not sure what it is. And fried eggs. Those were my eggs. And just a lot of imaginative things that people don't do now.
You know, I'd forgotten about those big exposed roots because
they
just, if you wanted to make roads for cars, you could kind of use those for boundaries. Those
right.
were great fun.
Well, they were always, it was always my house. And, of course, the more roots, the bigger the house was.
Yeah.
And one was the kitchen. And I didn't have didn't have a tea set at this particular time, but I would pick up odd pieces of glass, you know, how people used to throw out their old dishes and all, and that was my dishes. And a little bottle cap would be my pan, you know, my frying pan for those.
Oh,
little,
a lot of imagination.
Lot, and somehow or other that's kind of gone out the window.
Well, there's too much they can do now to be that creative anymore.
Another thing I mentioned, that this wasn't exactly a toy, but my mother would take the back of her hand, you know, do a fist like,
yeah.
And put a kind of a blanket around it, like a baby, and put little eyes on,
yeah.
And mouth, and that was a baby. You know, she taught me how to do that, and so that was my doll.
Yeah,
sometimes.
Yeah, and plus you could open and close your fingers and make a mouth.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So those were good times.
You take care. I'm glad you called. Do it again.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. 1-800-572-8255. And an interesting story in the paper, USA Today. British confer knighthood on the King of Comedy, on Bob Hope. It's kind of a sad, it's a cover story in the life section, and it's kind of sad, but you're delighted that he's being honored with a knighthood. The story says he's fragile, wispy-haired, and his rapid-fire quips have slowed to near silence, but the shuffling gait can't quite conceal a hint of a jaunty dancer stride or the jaw that's perpetually on the verge of a one-liner and that ski slope nose. On Sunday at the British Embassy in Washington, D.C., Bob Hope received the umpteenth honor of his career at an honorary British knighthood, the latest in a string of awards stretching back a half century. Mr. Hope was born Leslie Towns in Eatham, England, but raised in Cleveland and a U.S. citizen. The most American of comedians shares an honor also bestowed on other people, Andre Previn, J. Paul Getty. It's hard to believe, but on May 29th, Bob Hope turns 95. And according to the paper, he's no longer touring, no longer on TV, except for a fleeting appearance in a commercial. Almost completely deaf and blind, he now appears in public mainly to pick up awards and accolades. He's occasionally seen, but seldom heard. For a performer renowned for his energy and ability to crack wise, being past your professional prime can be lonely and embittering. Good story, kind of sad, about Bob Hope, who is about to turn 95 years of age. And you're talking about a guy who has just literally conquered every phase of show business, going way, way back. He really has. Movies, television, radio, Bob Hope. 1-800-572-8255. Telstar International Communications gang, long distance for 10 cents a minute, home or business, no tricks ever. Let's go to Woodruff, South Carolina, and talk to Reb on the radio.
Good morning.
How you doing?
Pretty good. A little warm, though.
Good. Okay, well, a little too warm for me, but you got to put up with it till September.
You happened to mention Bob Hope, and I think of his greatest one-liner. You know that slightly mincy, effeminate walk that he has?
Yeah.
He was playing golf. He was about to putt. And as he walked up to address the ball, a youth in the crowd said, "Your slip is showing. He never missed a beat." He said, "So's your father's." And when it comes to toys, when I was a kid in Brooklyn, New York, we had rubber guns.
Oh.
I almost put Olympic skaters' career to an end.
Really?
I shot her in the left knee. Sonia Klotfer, she skated with Dick Button in the 47 or 48 Olympics.
I'll be darned.
We used to cut little pieces of linoleum, you know, that heavy flooring.
Yeah.
Into little diamond-shaped pieces, and we'd put them in the rubber guns and shoot them. I stuck one right in her left knee.
Ooh.
Hmm. Ooh. I almost left home on that one.
Yeah. Well, we all had those occasions when we knew that the police were coming after us because we had been bad. And Lord knows we were.
The only toy I missed was a toy that I had called Orbi Orbit. It was shaped like a tadpole, only about as large as a baseball with a tail on it. And it had revolving suction cups. And when you pulled a string in the back of it,
yeah,
you could put it at the base of the wall, it would walk up the wall.
I remember.
I only had one of them, and somebody stole it, and I cannot find another one.
I remember seeing those. I don't think I ever owned one, but
Orbit.
Kind of amazing little thing. You had to lick those suction cups so it would leave tracks on your mother's wall.
I like that little bank that came out. It sat there and whirred. You put the penny in it. In the slot,
uh-huh.
And it whirred, and the door opened, and a green hand reached up and snatched the penny. That was a good one.
I love it. You take care
Enjoy
of yourself.
Your program. Have a good day.
Talk to you soon, buddy. 1-800-572-8255. Listen. There is a spring in the North Georgia Mountains, very, very close to where I live. Matter of fact, within, I guess, 3-4 miles of where I live as the crow flies. It's where they get their water for their Frosty Mountain Pure Spring Water. Pure spring water. It is nothing added, nothing messed with, doesn't come out of a tap anywhere. Comes out of this beautiful spring, which sits there just the way God put it there. It is delicious. I want you to stop and pick some up the first chance you get. Remember the name now, because there are a lot of these on the market. Frosty Mountain Pure. Underline that. Frosty Mountain Pure Spring Water. You're going to know immediately why I'm so in love with it, because it tastes better. You go in your favorite store. If they don't have it, you ask them to get it for you. It's Frosty Mountain Pure Spring Water. Tell them Ludlow sent you.
Ellie calls for a hot, filling breakfast. Swanson has a simple solution. The kids are slowly moving. The school bus is quickly approaching. But with Swanson, you can still get them well-fed, energized, and off to a great start. Swanson Great Starts lets you put a hot breakfast, like fluffy eggs and sausage or cinnamon swirl French toast, on the table in under 5 minutes. So after they roll out of bed, nothing gives them a jump start like Swanson Great Starts breakfast. Have you looked into Swanson Great Starts lately?
Channel 2 Action News at 5 with Monica Kaufman and Don Farmer. Live in-depth coverage of the day's top stories. Medical news from Health Team 2 and consumer investigations with Clark Howard.
This is the fastest growing area of consumer fraud.
Channel 2 Action News at 6 with John Pruitt and Monica Kaufman.
The Atlanta Federal Penitentiary remains locked.
For the most complete local news coverage that's straightforward, clear, count on the anchors who know Georgia. Channel 2 Action News at 5 and 6. Coverage you can count on. You want to know what the weather is now.
On Doppler Radar 2, we're looking at showers moving into Clayton County this morning.
You need to know what the weather will be like tomorrow.
3D Weather Vision gives us a good look at the cold front and the rain rolling into North Georgia right now.
You have to be prepared when severe weather hits your neighborhood.
Storm Tracker 2 radar showing the snow squall in Carroll County headed for Marietta by 7:30.
Glenn Burns, Karen Minton, and David Gently. Professional, experienced, accurate. Channel 2 Action News. Weather coverage you can count on.
Hi, I'm State Superintendent of Schools Linda Schrenko. One way to teach children to read is to make it fun. Public libraries are the best places to supplement your child's school reading program because libraries connect a child's interest to books. The door to a world of wonder is the door to your local library. If reading doesn't come first, it doesn't matter what comes next.
For more information, call the Georgia Department of Education at 404-656-2800.
Hi, neighbors. This is Ludlow Porch on News Radio 960, the new WRFC.
Mom and Dad got married and dropped out of junior high, for they were blessed with triplets, Velma, Thor, and I. Of children there came many more, and as the tribe increased, we found this humble home of ours where the love has never ceased.
Love in a refrigerator box, a shiny new refrigerator box.
Folks would say we had it rough, but we dug around and we found plenty of stuff.
Love in a refrigerator box.
Bethlehem, Georgia, and Greta on the radio. Hello there. How you doing, my friend?
Doing great. How are you this morning, Ludlow?
Doing good. Thank you.
The reason I was calling is about those favorite toys.
Yeah.
When my cousin and I grew up near Nashville, and we always played Grand Ole Opry, and we would go out in the woods near the house to look for this great big wide stump. Then we'd get a stick, and she would be Loretta Lynn, and I was always Tammy Wynette.
And the stump was your stage?
That's right. The stump was the stage, and of course, she would be the audience when I would sing, and I'd be the audience when she would sing. Then we would get off the stage, and we would go on tour in our big buses, and our big buses were two concrete blocks.
Oh, that's fun stuff. How old were you?
Oh, about 4 and 5.
Old enough to know about the Grand Ole Opry.
That's right. Grand Ole Opry's been around a long sometime.
That is wonderful. You take care of yourself. I'm glad you called.
Thank you, sir. Goodbye.
Bye-bye. 1-800-572-8255. Interesting story in the paper about, of course, a lot of interesting stories about Sinatra. And if you watched any over the weekend television, I think you really saw what this country thought about Frank Sinatra. It's kind of disturbing little story in the paper. Said Sinatra leaves an empire estimated at $200 million that could become a battleground. The family has repeatedly denied that fourth wife Barbara is feuding with the singer's children, Nancy, Tina, and Frank Jr., over who owns the rights to his song and who controls licensing of his name and images. A man who worked for Frank Sinatra as a valet from 1974 to 94 says there will be fireworks over dispensation of Sinatra's assets. Barbara has control over all of Frank's assets, and the kids don't have anything, he says. They'll flip out when they realize it. Calls to Harvey Silbert, who is Frank Sinatra's lawyer, were not returned. September Wall Street Journal story reported that Sinatra's will was rewritten within the last 5 years. Only Frank and I know its content, Silbert was quoted as saying. At stake, royalties, music publishing, companies, business and real estate interest, as well as a large art collection, including some of Frank's own paintings. So I hope that does not come to pass. I hope if there is a feud about that, that it's not a public feud. I hope these folks, there's enough money there for everybody, everybody to live great for the rest of their life. All right, now let's... Tomorrow, I want you to be sure and be with us because we are going to talking about Medicare, Medicaid, and we'd like to have you here. We're going to be some good information tomorrow, and hopefully we can get some of your questions answered so you make your plans to leave your dial right where it is. Between now and then, you do me a favor. Whatever else you do today, you find somebody to be nice to.
Celebrating 50 years of service to Northeast Georgia, we're News Radio 960, WRFC, Athens.
From ABC News. Joan Bennett. A court battle which President Clinton says could have a huge impact on the U.S. economy is about to get underway. The Justice Department is suing Microsoft to force the software giant to ease its vice grip on the market. ABC's Steve Taylor.
Attorney General Reno and the states were ready to bring their lawsuits last Thursday, Joan, but Microsoft lawyers asked for time to talk to try and reach a settlement out of court. Those negotiations went nowhere on Friday and broke down on Saturday. The government insisted that Microsoft make it easier for competitors to be used with its Windows software, and Microsoft insisted it would be cutting its own throat to do that. Joan?
Microsoft began shipping Windows 98 to PC makers today for retail sale beginning June 25th. President Clinton and British Prime Minister Tony Blair talked with Pakistan's Prime Minister by telephone today, trying to convince him not to conduct underground nuclear weapons tests. The U.S. has suggested it might lift a ban on shipments of conventional weapons to Pakistan if it behaves. Francis Tuza, who edits a defense newsletter, says the Pakistanis may get a better offer.
I suspect you'll find most Islamic nations will be rooting for the Pakistanis to go ahead and test. They may even be willing to offer them money to make up for any shortfall of funds that, say, the United States or the International Monetary Fund would cut off.
There are hints that an American effort to jumpstart Mideast peace talks may be working. Israeli radio said today Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has agreed to U.S. demands to withdraw troops from 13% of the West Bank, provided that he wouldn't be required to hand over more land later. Secretary of State Madeleine Albright is attending a hastily arranged meeting in London with Palestinian leader Yasser Arafat. Rolling Stones had to postpone their European tour, which was to start Friday. Seems Keith Richards fell off a ladder at his Connecticut home this weekend, injuring his chest. On Wall Street, the Dow is down 33. This is ABC News.
When disaster claims a victim, a life can be rebuilt. If a teen gets into trouble, he can find help helping others. Should addiction grip a father, a family can help him heal. Every day in your community, the Salvation Army helps turn lives around. Call 1-800-SAL-ARMY.
Sponsored by Friends of the Salvation Army.
Expecting a benefits check in the mail? Soon most Social Security, SSI, and other federal benefit checks will have to be direct deposited into an account, leaving thousands of payments, even yours, without an account to go to. But if you join the Western Union Benefits Quick Cash Program, you can pick up your money at any Western Union agent location as soon as it's available, and you won't have to wait around for the mail. The Western Union Benefits Quick Cash Program. No hassles, no checking, no waiting. To enroll, see your local Western Union agent or call 1-800-FEDCASH. That's 1-800-333-2274.
The afternoon update continues now on News Radio 960 WRFC. Good afternoon, I'm Beth Larson. Currently, we have...